Hello, I'm going to give you some help with page 26 of Traurey Book 1, which is all about the fourth finger. So if you've already done some tapping and maybe some plucking, all of that is very good for the fourth finger. And there's one little exercise I'm going to quickly show you, which I've only recently learnt myself. So I've got here a little square of kitchen paper, and I'm going to ball it up and tuck it in the curve of my left hand little finger, and then just roll it up and down. You can sit and watch telly while you do this or whatever. It just gets that joint nice and loose and helps all of the little ligaments to flex. Maybe gives your little finger a job to do, because it's probably never had a job until now. When you're doing something slightly new on the violin, you should always try to avoid battling with two things at once. So there are two separate issues here. One is using the fourth finger and getting it to make a decent sound, and the other is reading the notes and knowing when it should be a fourth finger or should it be something else. And I'm going to split those two apart and say, I'm not going to look at page 26 for now. I'm just going to play my violin and make sure I use the fourth finger sometimes. So I'm going to choose a string. I shall choose the A string and then just play. I might use the fingers in order at first, because that's going to be easier, and I'll just randomly go up and down. I don't have to worry with having to read notes at the same time as having to worry about my little finger. I could also try something a bit more adventurous. So this time I'm going to try jumping to my fourth finger. So I'm going to start with three fingers on, and I'm going to go 3-4-3-4, and then 2-4-2-4, 1-4-1-4. That's my third finger. And I could make up more little exercises like that. I could do that one the other way around. So I always go from open and work my way up. When the little finger is on, it should have that nice curved shape like that. And it wants to try to have the same shape when it's on as when it's lifted, and try not to let it lift off and ping over here. All of those things, if your little finger doesn't seem to want to behave quite so easily, then you're in good company, because everybody's little fingers are a bit eccentric at first. They just don't have enough to do in our lives, I think. And then when we start asking them to do things, they're like, "Ooh, it'll get there, don't worry. It may feel like it won't, but you will be able to train it." So now I am looking at page 26 on Traurey Book 1, and I can see in exercise 1 that he's marked in the fingers. Actually, we don't really need those to be marked in, because we know the note A very well. And then you can see each note steps up one by one until you get to the fourth finger, and he puts that big line along. That just means hold the fourth finger down for all of that bar, because they're all of those notes you'll need it on the string for anyway. So the first line should end up sounding like this. So take it steadily, don't go too fast. And also, I would say use the lower half of the bow for the crotchets at the beginning of the exercise. Then you have a minim, which can be a whole bow, and that means that the rest of... I'm watching myself in the camera and it's no good because it's the wrong way around. In the rest of that line, then the next four crotchets will be in the upper half because I'm at this end of the bow. And there are the last two minims. So just be aware that the crotchets are not always in the same half of the bow. When you've learnt exercise one, you'll find he so often does this. Exercise two is the same but on the D string. Exercise three is the same but on the E string. Exercise four is the same but on the G string. So make life easy for yourself. Whichever one of those you find the easiest, do that one lots and then transfer it to the other strings. I wouldn't give each one equal time. I would do the first one that's easy and then transfer onto the other slightly more difficult strings and then maybe improve those a bit so that they're up to the standard of the first one. So exercise five is a bit more tricky because it jumps around more. It actually uses three different strings if you look carefully. So it starts off on the A string. The last note of the first line of it is on the D string. And then you're back onto the A string and not long after that, you're on the E string. So I would just have a look through and point out to yourself, this is without the violin in your hand. I would just literally look first and point out which bits are on which string, just so that you really know that before you start. Then I might be also have a little look for things like steps up and steps down, just to have a look at the musical shape of the line so that you know what to expect. Again, this is without the violin in your hand. This is just you looking at the notes. And another thing is quite useful to do is to count up, you know, every time you get first finger on A, count all of the first fingers on A, or count all of the second fingers on A, or whatever it is. Just that just really helps get your eye in to reading those notes. Then I would probably say, have a go at playing it, but maybe rather than aiming to play all eight bars in one go, aim to play the first two bars. Just say to yourself, I'm going to aim to play the first two bars with no muddles. If you have a muddle, go back and have another go and do it that way. And then try bars three and four without a muddle. And then maybe go right from the beginning and do the first four bars with no muddle. Build it up in small sections. That's so much quicker than starting at the beginning and grinding your way through to the end and then collapsing in exhaustion. It's easier just to work at each section and then piece it together. I'm going to play that number five to you now so that you know what it's supposed to sound like.